You're listening to Side Hustle Pro, the podcast that teaches you to build and grow a side hustle from passion project to profitable business. And I'm your host, Nikayla Matthews. So let's get started. This is Nikayla here, kicking off a brand new month of Side Hustle Pro. You may have noticed that I took a mini break and there was no Side Hustle Pro last week. And surprisingly, even though it was a holiday weekend, it was actually really hectic for me. I had two back-to-back weddings, then I flew across the country to a work conference, and now I'm back at home. And it was just really good to take a beat. You know, I'm realizing now that I'm in the final weeks of wedding planning, I just need to surrender. I need to surrender to the process, surrender to this moment, and acknowledge that this is a crazy time in my life, crazy but good. And I'm not in complete control, and it is what it is. So if you haven't heard from me, if it seems like I'm MIA, and if my social media posts and communications have slowed down, it's because I have slowed down. I am surrendering to this current moment because I have three jobs, my day job, my side hustle, and my wedding. And I know it'll be over sooner than I think, and I'll be back at full steam. But for now, I want to live and breathe in this time and just taken every second because it will be over before I know it. So that's what's up with me. Anyway, enough about me. Let's get to today's guest. Today on the show, we have a woman who is a millennial CEO shaping Black digital media. How dope is that? Let me say that again. We have a woman who is a millennial CEO shaping Black digital media. Her name is Morgan Dabon, and she is the founder of Blavity, one of the fastest growing digital media startups and a top destination for Black youth culture. In March 2017, she launched a new lifestyle brand called 2190, a website focused on beauty, health, and wellness for women of color. She is one of only 12 Black women to raise over $1 million in venture funding and has been featured on the likes of Essence, New York Magazine, and was a finalist for 2016 TechCrunch Founder of the Year. I first encountered Morgan at the Blavity Empower Her conference back in 2016. I was already impressed enough with Blavity to buy a ticket, but what Morgan created in that room really sealed the deal for me. I just knew I needed to start Side Hustle Pro as I was sitting there in that conference. As a matter of fact, when the MC asked, I forget what the question was, but she basically asked, who wanted to share a new initiative or something we were working on? And I raised my hand, jumped out of my seat, and got on stage and announced to this room full of Black women creators and entrepreneurs that I was starting Side Hustle Pro. And there was just no turning back after that. So it's a real pleasure to welcome Morgan to the guest chair today. But before we get up close and personal with Morgan, I want to let you know that this podcast is brought to you by ZipRecruiter. Are you expanding your team? Are you looking for the right candidate that is going to jump right in, not only with the skills, but the passion and proactiveness to help you scale your business? Then head over to ZipRecruiter.com. I know that hiring can be one of the most challenging tasks for new business owners, and there's no blueprint to building the perfect team. But there is one website that can simplify the recruiting process and make your life easier. If you're looking to hire top talent for your business and take it to that next level, go to ZipRecruiter.com. With ZipRecruiter.com, you can post your job to 100 plus job sites with just one click. Let ZipRecruiter's powerful technology match your job to the right candidates and use their simple dashboard to find the right hire. Then easily select the best candidates from one list. 80% of jobs on ZipRecruiter.com get a qualified candidate in just one day. And over 1 million businesses have already used ZipRecruiter. So try ZipRecruiter for free today at ZipRecruiter.com/hustle. Now, let's get into it. Welcome to the guest chair, Morgan. So this month, we are devoted to teaching entrepreneurs pathways to fund their business. And I thought, what better person to talk to than you? You have had tremendous success, not only in founding Blavity, but also in raising capital. And we'll get into that a little bit later. But first, I want to go back to the early days, then bring it forward. So tell us a little bit about your background.
So a little bit about me. I'm from St. Louis, Missouri, Midwest for life. Although I do currently live in Los Angeles, I started my career in Silicon Valley working at Intuit in tech. And yeah, I learned a lot about like design thinking and creating experiences for specific user personas and thinking really about how do we create awesome products with an intentional person in mind and a problem that you're trying to solve. And that was kind of my playground early on at post-grad life before I started Blavity, where I learned a lot about how to create cool products and how to create great experiences.
So prior to that, did your upbringing influence your entrepreneurial drive at all? Like, did you have any inclination that you'd one day be an entrepreneur?
Yeah, I was like one of those kids always trying to hustle people. So like I always use this example because it's so true. Like my brother, who I love to death, he's 2 years older than me. So I was a little sister, and he was like good at managing money, but I was a little bit better at it. So he'd be like, "Okay, like can I have some money?" And I'd be like, "Sure, like we're gonna sign this piece of paper. Like I'm getting a 25-cent like payment fee," which was, I didn't really know what interest was. Or like I would create Kool-Aid and mix it with sugar and make it like a bootleg Fun Dip and sell it at my middle school. So yeah, I was always hustling people trying to make money. And then my parents probably should have known like this isn't gonna go away. Like this is just who she is. But I didn't really, I think, like envision growing a business and being an entrepreneur until like as a real career until I was in college, actually. So yeah.
What happened in college to make you start thinking about it?
I think I just saw the potential of scale and like how impactful businesses are at creating opportunities and creating access and influencing the rest of the culture in terms of like, donating to different campaigns or like making hiring decisions, being in and out of communities in terms of like urban development. And I didn't know any of that in my little world until I started studying and taking different classes and talking to different business leaders and like learning from my peers in college as well.
So speaking of college, now I have listened to you talk a few times, read up on you, of course, in preparing for this episode. And I understand that college was instrumental in the beginning of Blavity. I mean, did you know at the time or you just knew your co-founders then?
Yeah, I just knew my co-founder. So Jeff, who is our CTO, he was, I was one of those crazy ambitious people who went to campus before campus was really open. So I took like a free freshman summer program and he was my RA in that program. And he was student body president at the time. And I was like, who is this like dorky black guy who got entire campus to like vote for him? He always wore suits all the time. And I was like, this is crazy. And so he convinced me to run for student, a freshman class president, which you had to do like the first few weeks of school freshman year. So I would like put together my campaign team. We ran against like five or six other teams. We won. So then I was in student government and it was a wrap from there. I ran for student body president and he was my mentor, the entire way. And he was 2 years older. And then Aaron Samuels, who's our COO, he was at the time one of the most amazing poets I'd ever met in my life. I'd, read poetry, but I'd never like seen someone perform poetry. And, he's a slam poet and a writer. And he was creating our first campus poetry group. And so he needed funding. So he would always be like lobbying me because I was student body president to like fund his projects and his ideas. And it was, and we became friends through that. And then we were also in a few other groups together. And then Jonathan, who's head of our corporate brand and corporate strategy, he and I were in like a secret society that wasn't really secret together. And so we met through that. So yeah, all these guys, we were all in different classes, which was really cool because, it's when you're on a college campus, it can feel really big, but at WashU, which is the school we went to, the community was really close-knit and we were able to like form relationships and hang out and like teach each other different things and stayed in touch after graduation.
Nice. And it's so cool that you were like in all these leadership positions, student body and government and all of that. And that I'm sure has helped you with leading the business.
Yeah. I think I managed more money in college than I do now, which is funny. WashU has a lot of money, but yeah, I definitely think those experiences gave me a little boost in terms of practicing my leadership skills.
Okay. So now for the people who, for whatever reason, are listening to this podcast and have not heard of Blavity, tell us what it is and what does it mean?
So Blavity is a media company and community at this point for like young Black people in the United States. We tend to be really creative makers, thinkers, entrepreneurs. A lot of people who are in cities like New York, Chicago, DC, Atlanta, Houston, Dallas. And we have a website, you know, blavity.com. We create content, news content, editorials. People can submit their ideas, their own stories. If they're really feeling something, like Beyonce, you know, when she announced she was pregnant with twins, we got like 30 submissions and they were all fantastic and funny. And then we have two conferences. We have our women's conference, which is called Empower Her. And then we have AfroTech, which is a tech conference in November. And then now, recently, we just brought on two new brands. One has been around for 8 years called Shadow and Act. And then the other one is a new brand that we created in-house called 2190, which is just for women. So it's a really fun company. We're super creative and we're based in downtown LA. We have a studio and an office in downtown LA.
And then Blavity.
Oh, the word. Yeah. So the word means Black gravity. And it's a phrase that we used in college when it would be like a couple of people sitting at the lunch table and all of a sudden there's way too many people sitting at a table that only fits eight. And you've got people arguing, talking about like what happened in class, what did the outfits do? Like, why aren't you in class right now? Why have you been sitting here for like 5 hours? Like you just skipped two classes. And yeah, it was what we said, you know, Blavity is happening. Like, where did you guys come from? So yeah, it was so funny when I graduated, like I didn't realize that wasn't a word other people knew. So when I was thinking about what to name the company, I was brainstorming with Jeff, our CTO. And I was like, what about Blavity? He was like, oh my God, that's great. I was like, wait, is this free? This is free? And it was a wrap. It was over. It was over after that.
When I heard you speak at last year's Empower Her, one thing distinctly stood out to me. You talked about the fact that you should not be side hustling on your company's time like you used to. Go take your lunch break, drive somewhere else, and work on Blavity. So talk to us about the beginning of Blavity, how you were able to juggle, and what was your approach to side hustling?
Yeah, that can get you in trouble. I mean, definitely in the tech world, you should not use company resources for your side hustles because you don't want them to be able to claim they own any of your intellectual property. My recommendation is like, you've got to treat this like a job, right? Like you want to go somewhere, you want to be somebody, you want to, you know, actually walk the walk, not just talk about it. You have to put in the hours. So, you know, I was waking up, you know, 6 a.m., 7 a.m., working for 2-3 hours, you know, hustling and getting to work, taking my lunch break, working on stuff during my lunch break. And then after work, I wasn't grabbing beers with guys, right? Like I wasn't like going to this meetup or this meetup to like listen to other people talk about things like that. You know, like I was not about that life. I'm still not about that life. Yeah. I was in my apartment working and I would make my friends come hang out with me with the whiteboard and make them work with me. Like I distinctly remember one of my friends was like, let's hang out. I was like, okay, great. Like, come over. I'm trying to build user personas. And that's what we did. So yeah, it's a lot of dedication. And I think people should focus on progress and execution, not just like the process of thinking you're doing something.
For sure. I talked about that with a number of people about you make to-do lists and you feel so accomplished. Like, all right, I organize everything I want to do. Like, that's not real work. Yeah. So now, how long did you side hustle and how advanced was Blavity before you fully made the leap? Was it like launched as a website, making revenue?
Yeah. So I would say, and most people probably don't actually know this story because I like to keep clean stories out in the universe or else people are like, I don't get it. When did it start? So I started thinking about it and started gaining, I think, like emotional confidence in January 2014. And Jeff and I were already working on a few little like side hustle projects. And then I was like, all right, I know that I want to prep myself to build a company. Like I'm committed to quitting my job and shooting my shot. I don't know when, and I don't think I can afford to do it right now, but I'm committed to this idea that I'm going to get there. And so I started just throwing out different ideas, getting people's thoughts. And then by March, so January to March, you know, had the name, had the first version of the product of what we wanted to do and the problem that we were trying to solve, which was a newsletter. It was a weekly newsletter that we'd send out with the top Black videos that you needed to see that week. No website, like no Instagram, like nothing. And then did that for a few weeks, proved this kind of concept of, okay, Black content is where I'm going, and building some sort of destination site for curated or user submitted content is where we're going. So now we're in the summer, and by then it was just me, and I kind of had Jeff on board. I would have been talking to Aaron maybe like once every 2 weeks, like kind of like on a consultancy basis. And I would like meet up with Jonathan in picnic and in parks in downtown San Francisco. But they were, you know, everybody still had their full-time jobs. So that's when I think I really started hustling, was like over the summer. But we launched in July 2014. Everybody flew to Nashville, which is where my parents live. And we had a few days of just like not sleeping and getting it to a place where we could publicly have a website. And then after that, so now we're in July 2014. So that's like our official Blabberty started in July 2014 story. And then I quit my job in October 2014. So I was working, you know, on the side from, you know, basically February to October. And I definitely think I quit prematurely. Like, we didn't have any users. We had some. We definitely hadn't hit an inflection point that normal people would say, yes, you should quit. But what had happened was a lot of the Black Lives Matter stuff had started to scale up. And I felt like emotionally, like I needed to do more and I needed to be committed, and that I would never get to the next level and the company would never get to the next level if I was not 100% focused and really dedicating my time. So that's when I took the leap of faith and quit and worked on the company for a full year, you know, just sitting in my San Francisco apartment. And then the guys eventually were able to quit after I raised.
How were you surviving in expensive San Francisco at this point for this year that you were building it out and you would quit your job?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'm a hustler to the day I die. I got multiple streams of income always. I mean, just because I didn't have a full-time job with benefits didn't mean I wasn't getting paid, right?
A true hustler. Y'all hear that? Like, you have to start thinking outside of the box. If you want to quit these jobs, you still need money.
I lived in the Blavity office for a year. I just moved out.
Now, we'll get to the office and things like that and the raising. But first, how many people visit the site each month as of today?
We get around 1 million people a month.
And so what were some of the first steps you took to take Blavity from this idea, this initial website, to this hugely influential brand and platform?
So we spend a lot of time trying to really listen and observe what was already happening and figure out how we can add value versus saying, we know what we're doing and this is what you all need. So really what that comes down to is creatives and people who are making cool things but need help distributing those cool things. So a lot of what we do, I mean, we have a full-time person and all they do is literally curate, find dope people in different cities, ask them what they need, and then we try to help them. So that was the best way for us to grow in the beginning because we also couldn't afford to make what they were making, right? So whether that's a video series or a cool Instagram account or a photojournalism project, what we could do was build systems and processes to distribute their content for them, right? And so that was kind of that mutually beneficial relationship that we started off with in the beginning. And then as we built more and more scale, because people were sharing the content that these people were making, then we were able to say, okay, here are some gaps in the market. We saw a gap with news, so we hired news editors, right? We saw a gap with Black women's lifestyle content, and so we made 2190. Or video series, you know, we're thinking about scripted video series and web series. So, you know, 3 years in, now we can say, okay, we know where the market is. We know what people have access to. We know where no one's creating stuff here. This is where Blavity can add value.
And I really like what you had to say about really listening to people before you just shove content down their throats and having a platform where people can contribute. It's like, what better way to reach people and to talk about what they're interested in than to let it be kind of crowdsourced?
Yeah, totally. BuzzFeed has done that quite a bit with their community submissions, and then WorldStar.
Oh, boy.
You know, love it or hate it, they exist.
So then which subsets of Black culture did you specifically want to target? Because I know I've heard you say you didn't want to get into the entertainment gossip blog realm.
Yeah, so the ones that we've identified, and it ebbs and flows depending on what's going on. Like early on in Blavity's life, Afrofuturists were like super big of a subculture. Lately, that type of content hasn't done as well. I don't know if people are like switching what they're interested in or what exactly is happening there. Things that are doing well for us that we're invested in are health and wellness, mindfulness, technology, tech, startups, entrepreneurs, film and entertainment, creators, people making web series, people making shorts, thinking a lot about social impact, social justice, and holding people accountable and like making sure that we're highlighting people who are doing really good things on a local level, because we can't necessarily count on our federal level at this point. So thinking a lot about like local politics, and we're certainly processing and thinking about music now that we've gotten a little bit bigger and have some resources. Music's a tough place to jump into because it's very crowded. But we think that there are some young Black artists who aren't necessarily getting the shine that they deserve, despite their like amazing, amazing music.
And one thing I don't want to skip over is the awesome job you guys did in coming out the gate and gaining this awareness. Like, it's not an easy thing. What was your initial launch strategy? I remember seeing these Blavity badges on my friends' profile pictures, the ones that went to watch you. Like, do you remember that? Tell me about this.
That's so funny. Yeah, that was like, I mean, that was like a rid, like week one.
Yeah.
I mean, it's by any means necessary. Like, there's so many things that we tried that you probably didn't see because it didn't work, right? But this was before Straight Outta Compton had done the meme generators where like you could upload your photo and get something superimposed on top of it. So we had all of our friends send us their photos and then we superimposed things on top of it for them manually so that they could change their Facebook photos and their Instagrams. We gave people GoPros. We gave people who are now huge, like Quinta B and Lo Miller from the travel blog, like all these people who are now huge. But 3 years ago, you know, they were still scaling. We gave them GoPros to literally just like follow them around and have them show us what their lives were like for a week. And then we chopped up these videos and put them on the site. I mean, we tried everything. So it's hard to say what worked.
Yeah. But that's how you have to be. You have to really think through the launch strategy, guys. So now you are where you are, and like, if you look back at everything, how and when did you start to reap profit and rewards from your business? And then what were the first things you invested back into the business?
Let's see. I think that we started to really have something on our first Empower Her conference. That was the first time we made a big investment. We weren't sure if we were going to make the money back, because running a conference is incredibly expensive. And then when it happened, it was like, oh, this was amazing. Like, this was phenomenal. And we had so many new relationships with brands and sponsors. And then also we were able to meet a lot of these women we've been talking to online in person. And then most importantly, we were able to connect them with each other. And that we found out that a lot of people didn't know each other. And we were like, wait a minute, like, we all need to know each other. Like, that's the real strength here. And yeah, the things that we invest in, and I think the thing that most people are surprised in is our team. Like, we spend the majority of our money on people, hiring people, recruiting them, relocating them in their salaries, and in their content, right? Our editorial team, our writers. And, you know, that's expensive. And I guess in terms of the return on that investment, I'm not sure we've fully recouped those investment costs yet. Right now we're getting close because everyone's been with the team for 3 to 6 months, but there is always kind of an onboarding period where everybody's trying to figure out how to work well with each other. And then you hit a good flow and you start to become efficient. And that's really where most businesses get the return on their investments. So we're not there yet.
Speaking of team, originally you were bootstrapping, right? You didn't take any venture funding for a long time intentionally. Tell us about your thought process at the time. Why did you do it that way?
Yeah. So, I mean, Blavity now, people can see it. They can visit the different websites. They can see our conferences. And they're like, oh, I get it. Like, they're a lifestyle brand and media brand. And they have like this technology platform that all their sites sit on. Like, I understand how they're a business, right? But when you say that like 2 years ago and none of it exists, like, I sound crazy. You know, it sounded like just too far-fetched. So knowing that, I didn't want to waste my time creating a fake story to get funding, which sometimes you have to do is like speak the language, you know, tell the story that investors are going to be able to understand, nail the pitch, right? I didn't want to spend time doing that. I wanted to spend time growing and building and having something valuable to justify all the things that I wanted to say. And so I took that financial hit the first year, bootstrapping and not paying myself, so that we had that freedom and that flexibility to grow the way we wanted to grow and to tell a story that we could stand behind. And because of that, I think, you know, now raising is less difficult. If I wanted to go raise more money, I could, but that's because we have something real. Mm-hmm. You know, we have something that, like, it's not fake Facebook likes. They're not fake traffic. Like, it's real. They're real people, and the engagement rates show that. So it was a tough first year, but it also gave us the flexibility to build something that we were all proud of.
And when did you ultimately decide to raise funds? And then how did you begin that process?
So one of the reasons we needed to raise funds, because we needed to hire people full time outside of myself and kind of what I was able to pay people as contractors. And, you know, there are people on our team now who've been with me for 3 years since, like, you know, literally the beginning, and they were working for pennies on the dollar. Right. So, like, to me, that was the main reason why we raised, is because I was committed and wanted to make sure that we were doing right by our team and that we were able to grow and scale. And we needed more space and more runway to fully build out the company before we were going to be able to turn in revenue. And I needed to have, you know, my full-time staff around me for that. So that was one thing. And then two, like, as we were growing and making these investments like Empower Her, it was just getting expensive, and you need money to be able to invest in those things so that you can get the return on investment. So we had a pretty strong business case for raising, where it's like, if you give me this, I will be able to return this investment. And we did that pretty well.
Speaking of the business case, what was your experience overall raising money? You know, walk us through this, like, we know nothing about it, in terms of, how did you know which investors to pitch to? Where did you find them? Who helped you with the process?
Well, I don't think I did a good job raising the first time, because I failed. I mean, I tried to raise the first time, realized that we weren't ready, like that I wasn't going to play the story game. And so didn't raise, and then just kind of kept chugging along until we got a little bit bigger. And then a lot of my current investors were because other people said, Morgan, these people are looking to invest. You really need to talk to them. Like, just do it. You know, I have a lot of really amazing people around me who have pushed me and have been there for me through this whole process. I mean, I think about Jason Towns. He's out of DC. I think about my friends who worked at Apple or Facebook, my friends at Facebook who used to give me Facebook ad credits because we couldn't afford ads. You know, just everybody, like, Blavity is a reflection of our community. It is not, you know, the Morgan Show at all. Like, there's so many people who have contributed to our success, particularly when it comes to, like, fundraising. You know, Charles King, who's now one of our largest investors, I remember sitting down with him in downtown San Francisco, and I was like, yeah, I just need like 25K. And he was like, I'm in. And I was like, okay, cool. Like, let's go. Like, you know, and he got it. You know, he understood what we were trying to do, but I couldn't back it up necessarily. And now, you know, he's one of our biggest investors, and strategically, Macro Ventures, they funded like Fences, a lot of other cool things that are about to come out. And now we strategically have a lot of business things that we can work on. And so it's a good fit. And that's been a relationship that's grown over two plus years now. So there's a lot of people who were shooting with me in the gym who now are doing quite well, and we can do well with them. So I think people should, when they're thinking about raising, think about people who are strategically aligned with what you're doing, because then the return on investment for them can oftentimes be more than just the cash amount. It can be something that contributes to their business, operationalizing something that they're working on, insights. For example, we have an angel investor, Michael Rothman, who owns and runs this company called Fatherly. It's a media company for dads. And he was one of the early folks at Thrillist. And it's great having him on board as an investor, because I can call him and be like, yo, our traffic keeps going down. Like, what's the deal? Is it Facebook? Am I doing something wrong? And just talk, having access to him and his knowledge helps me save money, right? And you want to get people around you where they're invested in your actual product and future, not just like a check.
That is truly the dream, right? To have that investor that you can learn from and they feel committed to not only the hopeful outcome, but also seeing your growth and progress.
Yeah, absolutely. But it takes time. You got to say no. Like, I turned down money because I was like,
Walk us through that too.
Yeah. I think like there's definitely people who wanted to invest and I'm like, but why? Like, we don't necessarily fit your investment thesis. Like, a lot of venture capital firms want to make businesses or fund businesses that are going to get returns like Uber or Lyft, mm-hmm. right? Where it's literally a $1 billion company. Now, can Blavity get to $1 billion? Yeah, but we shouldn't have to get $1 billion for someone to be happy, right? Like, the investors that we have would be very satisfied if Blavity got to $100 million. But there's a big difference between building a $100 million company and a $1 billion company, right? And so we wanted to get people on board who were going to be okay with the pace at which we were willing to grow, which is still, granted, relatively quickly, but it's not, you know, Snapchat quick, right?
And that's one of the things to really consider too with raising money. Like, great, you have money, but then you have people expecting a lot from you. And so there's additional pressure, there's additional input and opinions.
Yes, all the time. And it's great if you have great people. Like, I love the emails from my investors now.
So you mentioned that first 25,000 and where you've raised, what, over $1 million now or $1 million?
Yes, over $1 million.
How long did it take you to raise that? And what was the process as far as, so I know people suggested investors that were interested, but then were you also like cold calling or doing any pitch competitions?
No, I think those things, I mean, they work for some people. I mean, Blavity is a very unique business, right? I can't just like cold email
right
and be like, hey, I have a Black team and a Black startup and we're going to sell Black things like that. And I'm a Black woman and I want you to give me $1 million. Like, yeah. That statistically, I was not going to even attempt to go there. Mm-hmm. I think that the best way to attract investors is to build a strong business, period. And then to grow it and then have a reason why you need a loan, right? Like, a convertible note, which is usually how most people structure their first round of funding, is basically a loan. If you give me $500,000, I will be able to make $2 million, right? Like, until people can really outline how that's going to happen, they should not raise, because that's the expectation. I mean, it's more than that, right? But people need to be able to justify those things before they go out and say, like, the argument can't be, I need to raise because I need a salary because I want to quit my job.
So what happens after you raise the money? Speaking of salary, at what stage do you begin taking a salary? How often are you meeting with the investors?
Yeah, I'm supposed to send a quarterly update. I'm probably not their favorite founder in terms of transparency. And then, you know, you're supposed to reach out when you need something or when you have an issue. I meet with my investors, particularly because they're strategically aligned, whenever strategically I have issues or like need their help. So I'll meet with Charles's team about different stuff, probably, you know, definitely sending emails a couple times a month. And then the Knight Foundation is another investor. Like, I'm flying to Miami to talk to them about different things. So it's a constantly fluid situation. They do intros for me. I mean, investors should be your champions. They should be talking about you in rooms that you can't get in yet and speaking on your behalf. So my investors have definitely done that for us. And in terms of like salary, yeah, I mean, it's so funny. Like, sometimes I'm like, man, I should pay myself more. And then sometimes I'm like, man, we need that money to go and do this thing, right? And so I go back and forth. I adjust my payroll up and down depending on what's going on. So for the first year, well, I definitely wasn't paying myself my first year when I was in my apartment. And then year two, even after we got the office, I was barely paying myself, like, because I was living in the office. So my rent was basically covered through that. So I wasn't paying myself much, basically just my Ubers probably. So now we're, you know, almost to year three. I pay myself a little bit, barely, you know, now I've moved out the office. I'm barely covering my rent with my salary, but I also don't have that many expenses. You know, I'd rather invest that cash in a new content marketer or in making sure that the team, we can have like a retreat or like whatever it is, because the return on that investment is so much stronger than my, you know, being able to like go to Hawaii, which I don't have time for anyways.
Oh man.
Yeah, but I think most founders would say like, pay yourself first. And like, I agree with that. Don't struggle so much that you're not being efficient. But also, like, don't be exorbitant, because that's you're betting against yourself in some ways. because every dollar you save is a dollar you can put back into the business. And if you maintain ownership, a significant ownership of your company, then that's money that you're going to make later.
How do you find these dedicated and hardworking team members? Like, what are the nuggets you've picked up now?
Yeah, finding and keeping a strong team is like the most important thing. If I could give any like young entrepreneur advice, it would be really, really create a community and a squad of people who can rally with you around the vision and make a vision that is beyond you. It is not the Morgan show, right? Like everybody works hard because there's a mission, and like we see the rewards of us pushing our mission. Like we see the girl who had got featured on our Instagram account sell out of her product on Etsy, right? And like that is motivating for people. And so we try to find people who are aligned with that mission, because that's what's going to make them sustain in tough times. And we've had a lot of tough times in our company, you know, everything from losing big clients to like, we can't afford snacks this week, like just everything. And what weathers the storm and what is basically the fact that people are motivated by the work that they do every day. And I think finding those team members, I think it's really listening to what people say when you're talking to them. Like when we do interviews, and I think about people who are no longer with us on our team, you know, we hired them because they had a skill set that we thought we needed, as opposed to this is someone who's like really going to be about this mission and like really going to go the extra mile. Because in a startup, it's not just about skills. It's also about, you know, your heart and your passion.
I mean, if you can't find someone who's down during those hard times, they're going to be out.
Yeah, they're going to be out and they're going to be complaining and they're going to pollute everybody else. It's not worth it.
So how are you continuing to grow your brand and what's next for you guys?
Yeah, we went from one brand to three very fast. So right now we're in like a stabilized mode, not a growth mode. It's like, we've got these great things. We want to do make sure that we're treating them all with the attention that they deserve, that they all have a level of innovation and creativity. And so we're going to spend, you know, the rest of the summer really investing in the right content and positioning and making sure that they're providing value to their community. Shadow and Axe has been around again for 8 years. And so learning a lot from Tombe, who's the founder of Shadow and Act, and his community, which is incredibly loyal and very active, and asking them what they need and what they want. You probably won't see any new things in terms of like new brand, like, hey guys, we're doing a sports site. Like, no, like we're done. Hopefully this goes out soon. Cause then like, I don't want anyone to be like, Morgan, remember that podcast you did? And here we are. we're going to focus on what we have and make sure that everything that we have is excellent and well-executed and creative and unique and providing value.
Before we close out, we have a lightning round on this show. You just answer the first thing that comes to mind. Are you ready?
I'm ready.
Number one, what's a resource that has helped you in your business that you can share with the Side Hustle Pro audience?
The Lean Startup by Eric Ries book.
Who inspires you and why?
Oh, I mean, my team. Like every day, because they work so hard and they don't complain. And like when I'm not feeling it, they for some reason are still feeling it. And so, they just keep me going.
How do you decompress?
That's something I'm working on. I decompress now by like meditating and doing a daily devotional in the mornings when I wake up and kind of like praying and clearing my mind in the morning.
And now this one is, it's kind of new. I'm making this up on the spot, but who would you say is a fellow Black woman entrepreneur who has been most influential in your journey thus far?
Oh my goodness, that's so hard. I love it. I can't just pick one. Oh, okay, I have to give you three because okay. Three came to mind. One, Zim from Travel Noir. We have known each other for a while. We were both in San Francisco, and I just admire Travel Noir so much, like, and her specifically, like, design, being intentional about building a brand, saying no to things because it doesn't fit, building an independent, sustainable business model that doesn't rely on huge enterprise companies. Like, she's just done so many things that I admire. Two, Danielle Leslie. She's phenomenal. She helps and teaches other people how to make money online. And she's just like always dropping gems. Like, she's like, why are you doing this? Do this instead. And I'm like, yes, like, tell me everything. And then, you know, I think in terms of like girl boss goals, I think Jessica Matthews, from CEO of Uncharted Play, she's one of probably less than three women in the country, Black women, who've raised, you know, over $5 million in funding. And funding aside, I think that she has a very solid technical background and technical product and is doing something that could potentially change the world in terms of generating energy. If you guys haven't heard about her, look her up, Jessica Matthews. And she does it with grace and with her own vibe and her own style. And I just respect that so much. So those three women, and there's so many more, but I'll stop there.
Awesome, awesome choices. And then finally, number five, what's your parting advice for fellow women entrepreneurs who want to be their own boss, but are worried about losing a steady paycheck?
That's tough. I think the advice is, there's no better time to start than today and start working towards those goals. I think oftentimes we do a lot of researching and reading and asking people what they think, and you have to trust your gut and your intuition and just go for it. Not, you know, be smart, hustle smart, like don't waste your time or spend a lot of money for no reason. Oftentimes entrepreneurship is really just about progress and failing quickly. So get started, start like making things, start releasing things, and keep pushing.
Awesome note to end on. So Morgan, what's the best way that we can connect with you after this episode?
My Instagram has been thriving lately. I've gotten into Insta stories. So my Instagram handle and my Twitter handle is @MorganDubon. Hit me up, DM me, say what's up.
Oh, well, thank you for the offer, y'all. Take advantage of it. Morgan, thank you so much for joining us in the guest chair today.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me.
My pleasure. Alrighty, guys, and there you have it. Hey, guys. Thanks for listening to Side Hustle Pro. If you want to hear more from me, head on over to sidehustlepro.co/sidehustlecorner to get my weekly Side Hustle Diaries chronicles about my own journey from passion project to profitable business. And if you want to find me online, I'm @SideHustlePro on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. Don't forget to join the Side Hustle Pro Facebook community. Go to sidehustlepro.co/mastermind. And as always, if you love the show, do me a favor and subscribe, rate, and review on iTunes. Thanks, guys. Talk to you next week.